Today is the day we've been waiting 80 days for.
We're on a search for dogtooth tuna.
Literally travelled 1,000 miles.
Oh yes! Look at the size of it!
Morning and welcome back to another episode getting back to basics. I've got to be quick today because batteries are running out, but today is the day we've been waiting 80 days for. We're going to get out to the Outer Barrier Reef here. It's going to be hopefully incredible. And what exactly we're going to see, I'm not exactly sure, but the reason we're going out there is clear water, deep drop-offs, and it should be home to the dogtooth tuna. So it's going to be pretty incredible, but check out where we've just woken up. And we had a little visitor during the night, or a big visitor. Check this out. Come up the beach here, around our little campsite. It's a nesting green turtle. And then the tracks have come back down there. But yeah, it's quite amazing, really. When we pulled up on the sand cave, there was no other tracks. So I thought we might be a little bit early. But yeah, overnight, they've just coming in numbers. You can see another set of tracks here coming down. This time of year on the reef is just so incredible. Obviously you've got the turtles nesting just behind the camera there. We've got nesting booby birds. So there's all these little eggs underneath these booby birds, and they're such an incredible bird. They've got so much character. But out at the reef too, all the reef fish have just spawned last week, which is awesome. So there's heaps of big like spawning aggregations of fish, and there's a lot of courtship going on between the species, and hopefully I can capture it on camera for you. It's so cool. But the thing I wanted to show you right now is, oh, it's so sad to see. Yeah, there's this one big mother turtle that just didn't time her run well last night. Coming back down the beach, she's run into an obstacle course of big rocks. So you can see her tracks going up where she's laid, coming back down. But then the tide has gone out and it's a low tide. You can see her there. And I would love to, trust me, I'd love to just pick her up and support her and help her get down to the water. But I think she's actually safer here on the rocks if she's that exhausted. There's a lot of hungry tiger sharks out there that are here for that exact reason. They're gonna eat all the tide mama turtles. So honestly, the best thing I can do, the tide's incoming now. She's gonna wait like another hour on the rocks, and then she'll have that fresh, cool water coming up over and she'll be good to go. But I'll just come give you a quick look at her. Make too much noise and spook her and scare her to try and run across the rocks, but yeah, like I said, she'll be right in about an hour's time. That tide's gonna come in, so it's all good. And now we've got places to go. We've got to load the boat up, head offshore as far as we can, like right off the drop off, and see if we could find these big sea monsters, dogtooth tunas. After 82 days living aboard the Salty Dingo, we're out to attempt our first overnighter, like proper sleeping on board. We normally, as you guys know, find a nice little island, roll the swag out there. Not exactly sure how it's gonna work. It's all, it's pretty tight on here, but all I do know, it's gonna be squishy. So we'll figure it out once we get there. The other thing restricting us this trip is, man, the whole adventure we're doing, cameras just don't appreciate it, eh? So we started out with a drone, 5 GoPros, and some Sony Vlog Cam 2000 thingy, but yeah, basically the weather has just taken its toll on all of them. So no drone, one single GoPro left. So rather than on the way out getting all the transition shots of the drone shots of the dolphins and the turtles and everything, we're just gonna save the battery for the action stuff. And I guess it's a good time if you wanted to support the channel. Yeah, now's probably a good time to jump on board. We love going to these special places, but also love sharing it with you guys. So yeah, hence why we need some support so we can afford some more camera gear. Anyway, we'll see you out the reef, hopefully with some cool stuff's happening. All right, we have made it out here. It was a couple of hours, not as calm as we thought, a little bit choppy. But the incredible thing is we are 10 meters off the reef edge. And my sound has worked down to 370 meters, but it's not picking up. It's too deep. Must be like 500 meters deep at least. And that's the reef edge just there. You can see it just drops straight vertically down. Yeah, never in my wildest dreams thought we'd get out to this place. I hadn't even looked at it because it was just not viable. It was so far out of our reach, but 80 days at sea, you could get a long way. It's kind of overwhelming what to do, whether we fish or what, but I want to jump in and see what's underwater. So I'm going to throw a mask on and check out this drop off. Your fish. Fish, tell us what you got and how you got it.
We got these beautiful buffalo amperum.
Buffalo amperum.
We're chasing a smaller one first.
Yeah.
Because we really wanted a buffalo amperum.
Didn't we?
Yeah. We didn't want to get anything else but duck tunas and buffalo amperum.
Yeah. It's a shame the GoPro glitched and didn't film, but it was so impressive watching from the surface because. Bit of a background, these buffalo amperum, in my opinion, are the hardest reef fish to spear in Australia, full stop. They're just so cunning, so smart, they normally don't play games with you. As soon as they see you, they off. But this one, for whatever reason, Fran approached it the right way and it presented a shot. I have never actually eaten one, so I'm very interested to see what it tastes like. A quick update, the Dogtooth Tuna hunt has thus far been unsuccessful. Jumped in at a few different likely spots, but just for whatever reason, didn't see any doggies. Every time I chase them, it leaves me scratching my head, like where could they have been? We saw all the other key species, heaps of trevallies, heaps of mackerels, barracudas, but no Dogtooth Tuna. Now just after lunchtime, we came in and had a beautiful, beautiful swim just on the reef edge, and it literally drops from 2 meters down to 200 meters, like, it's kind of scary peering over. It's like peering over the edge of a high-rise building. It gives you like sort of vertigo looking over the edge. But we had a swim there. That's where Fran got that beautiful buffalo emperor. This is our lunch. Nanny guy, a bit of brown rice. Served with the view. So good. Too big for us to eat, so I'll get these hooks out quickly and get him back down there. So we keep getting busted off, trolling past this one. Pressure point's incredible. I was hoping they're big doggies. I'm sure they're doggies. They keep taking all their lures. Jumped in to have a look. Unfortunately, it's a little bit murky coming on sunset and it's just all sharks, a wall of sharks. But generally where there's sharks, there's doggies. So we're gonna try this first thing in the morning. See how we go. We're just finishing the day with a couple of fresh coconuts. We did think in advance with this. The only bad thing is our water supply. We had a drum of water somehow.
We didn't bring the wine.
It's just a tragedy. Our water's leaked all over the deck, so we're a lot lighter than we should be. We've got no water, but we've got some fresh coconuts and we don't have wine, which is unfortunate. Today was incredible. It was worth the wait to get out to the outer reefs again. Just the amount of fish life on a few of those spots we jumped in on when we were drifting was incredible. Like the just schools of trevallies and long-nosed emperor and the size of the coral trout. And it was just
Really, really cool to see. Watching Fran get that big buffalo emperor was something I'll never forget. That was incredible. Yeah, I'd love to have fished a bit more out here, but when you're in search of the dogs, you just got to put everything else aside. A lot of it was just jumping in at various points, trying to get those drifts right. And yeah, right at the end of the day, classic dog style, a big one turned up at the flasher when I least expected it, like a really big one, the one we were looking for, but it just wasn't that interested. Gave me like a sniff, I missed my chance, and yeah, hence why we're staying out here tonight to get the dog tomorrow. The sun's setting, we've got that big buffalo emperor to eat, but we're gonna switch cameras off, hopefully have an uneventful evening. We'll see you guys in the morning. Cheers. Good morning. It's day 83, living on board the Salty Dingo. Last night the 17-foot vessel got turned into a liverboard and it wasn't that successful. We were both, Fran and I, furiously ill through the night, which is just horrible. Like, I don't think between us we got two blinks of sleep. We reckon it was because there was an incident yesterday, not pointing fingers who it was, but there was an incident that spilt all of our water. And the only bit we could salvage was this water down the bottom of the drum. We filled this up from a creek, and I just think the algae to water ratio is not ideal, and it got to us. We needed to drink it, we were dehydrated, but yeah, we were just up all night with the most severe stomach cramps. Felt like someone was literally stabbing with a knife. It was horrible. Other bad news, sleeping down here, it's a little bit tight. And the Salty Dingo has sprung a leak. Every 2 minutes, the bilge pump turns on. And that's really, really loud and annoying. Not just to sleep, but also when your vessel's taking in water. So we're gonna have to look at that this morning. But there is some good news, there's some silver lining. Check out where we are. We're on one of the most remote reefs in the country. And the whole reason we came out and did an overnighter was so we could have a full day today exploring the reef. We're on a search for dogtooth tuna. They're just the most gnarliest fish in the ocean for so many different reasons. They got like the size and strength of a big tuna, but then they got the teeth of a shark, and then they fight dirty on the reef like a big reef fish. They're just incredible. Yeah, we're gonna have a coconut for brekkie, wetsuits on. Jump in and see if we can find the doggies. Are you happy, Fran?
Yeah.
You look stoked.
Straight drop from 1 meter to a couple of hundred meters. Let's get them.
Jump in the boat. Oh, that's so heartbreaking. Yeah, bugger.
How was it? Tell me.
So I went down as soon as I got in.
Yeah.
there's two big doggies came straight up at the flasher, yeah. Mouth up. I was like, oh my gosh. Both were like really big ones. Went and lined up at one. Oh, they sort of swam away and then came back. And I like, went down, lined up for the stone shot. Banged him straight through the top of the head, but it didn't stone him and he just took off and I couldn't fight him. And then as I was pulling it up, all the sharks came in and just like vaporized him, eh? Bugger. All right, take two. I need a better shot this time, I reckon. Like, it's pretty sharky, so I'll just yes! We got the dog! Woo! Stoned it! Oh, we got the dog! Oh, look at the size of it! Oh, he's fat! Whew. It was worth sleeping out here overnight! That's what it's all about! Wow! The Dogtooth Tuna! This is the fish we came out here looking for. As you saw, they're such a gnarly animal. Thank you, Fran, for being the best boatie on earth. Yeah, after those first couple, we knew we had to get a good shot on them. The sharks were really hot there, but generally, when the sharks are hot, there's doggies around, and this big guy just came in unannounced at the flasher, and I just knew I had to get that stone shot, and we got him out of the water before the sharks switched onto it. How good, eh? Such an impressive fish, man. They're just the kings of the reef. Absolute pinnacle of spearfishing right there. Oh, so lucky to be able to get out here and have a crack at them. That's epic. So there's this old ghost net that looks like it's drifted down from Indonesia or something, and it's hooked up on the reef here. But what it's done, it's created a FAD, which is a fish aggregation device. And yeah, the amount of fish around it's incredible, like all rainbow runners and trevallies, and they're all under the boat a minute ago. So we're gonna jump in and just have a look and do a bit of filming and see what's down there. Should be pretty cool. Boat ride back in was enough to break a man, his back and his boat, but we're gonna feast in success tonight. We've got we've got a lot of Dogtooth Tuna to get eating, so I think Fran's just about to hand it out. Oh, and also big thumbs up on this video for Fran being the best boat in the world. How's today? Without a blink of sleep last night. Wisdom tooth coming through, feeling sick, all the rest of it. Just bloody drove the boat like a champion and put us on the spot. That was incredible. So yeah, give the video a big thumbs up for Fran. All right, let's see the doggy. Can you lift him? You gonna need help? Feels very good to be back on dry land. It was a really long couple of days, but it was successful, so that was awesome. There's a couple of things I just wanted to say, but I didn't get the chance out there. It was all a bit too hectic. There was a bit going on, but number one is
that the only reason we shot this big tuna is that we pre-arranged, like, if the plan went down and it all worked out, with a mate who's got access to ice. And what we're gonna do, we're gonna trade a fillet of tuna with ice for him. So basically, we'll have one fillet. As you can see, we already started getting into it there. And ice, so that'll be able to last for like a week, and literally all we'll eat is Dogtooth Tuna. It's beautiful sashimi and steaks. And yeah, we'll give our mate the other fillet and he can share that with his friends and family. The other thing I wanted to say is please, please, please don't take this episode as a how-to blue water spearfish. I mean this quite seriously. Like, what we were doing today is not how you blue water spearfish. If you want to crack at Dogtooth Tuna like that, go on a charter where there's a boaty at all times, four or five divers, you're diving in a team, one up, one down, all the safety stuff. The reason I say that is because, as you would have seen with sharks today, they can be quite hairy, but the number one danger when chasing doggies is shallow water blackout, and doggies are responsible for more blackouts and more deaths in spearos than any other fish. So unfortunately, I've been in and around a couple of blackouts now. Luckily, they've been kind of good outcomes. They haven't happened to me, they've happened to my dive buddies, and they've managed to survive from them. But what we were doing out there today, we were just diving well within our limits, like just taking it real easy. Rather than pushing the dives, we were trying to outsmart the fish. So yeah, you should never target doggies alone. But I just wanted to say that, obviously, do as I say, not as I do on that one. Yeah, if you want to land one, grab a group of mates, go on a charter. You've got a far better chance. It's easier and it's safer, and you'll probably have more fun. All right. Thanks for listening. Hope you enjoyed the episode. I'm gonna switch the camera off now. I might get it going again when we have some sashimi and some doggy steaks. I'm gonna try and smash a couple of coconuts, rehydrate, and see ya for dinner. There's a bit of doggy sashimi. Just need some soy sauce. That's gonna turn into doggy steaks. I'm quite hungry. Fire's going. Made it back just in time. All right, I hope you enjoyed this episode, guys, from Fran and myself. We'll see you in a couple of days.